So welcome. Black Cajun Sports is proud to have one of the top Philadelphia college basketball coaches working today on the show. I got my guy, Pat Changes. How you doing, Pat?
You're gonna get me in trouble, man.
I'm from Darby Township. You from Newtown Square. We both from Delaware County. They try to tell me I'm not from Philly and all. So I claim it. I'm from Philly. And I'm gonna drag you in that with me, man. We Philly guys. We just happen to live in southwest Philly.
Hey, just so everybody understands, the top half of my family grew up in Philly, in West Philly, so Southwest Philly, in that region there near West Catholic. So I don't want to, you know, let's keep it real. It wasn't just Delco. We got some Philly in us for sure.
I did kindergarten and first grade at Heston Elementary over there in Parkside. Then I went out to Delco, man. So there,
we should be proud of that Delco too, though. We should be proud of that.
How's Courtney and the youngins, man? How's everybody?
I got two youngins to my left here. My sons are with me. We're doing great. We're following protocol, though. I mean, this is serious. So we're trying to stay very safe, very healthy, washing our hands, really quarantining ourselves, homeschooling. It's, man,
no,
that's hard.
No
I don't know
dates,
what's hard.
Man.
I don't
no
know
play,
what's hard. To
none
no
of that.
No play dates. No. I don't know what's harder, coaching in the Big Ten or homeschooling. It's, kids under 11, Del, hard.
I'm not going to put names out there, Pat, but I have actually had to Zoom tutor the children of a couple of basketball coaches on some fourth and fifth grade math. I actually had the Zoom tutor guys, kids. Man.
That's awesome. That's outstanding. But I hope everybody out there in Philly is safe and healthy and really taking this serious. We really talked to our guys over the last couple of weeks. We have team Zooms about taking this serious and not going to the gyms and not being around a group of people. Because look, we want to get back to school. We want to get back to working out. We want to get back to Penn State, and I'm sure everybody does. I want to get back to work. I can tell you that. So let's really follow these protocols and hopefully we can get back to some normalcy in the summer here.
We got off to a bad start with that. The kids were really being kind of reckless. And, you know, I did my part as much as I could. I called a few guys that were organizing things and I called a couple of the kids. You know, I'm close to a few of the kids. And I was like, I just don't want to see that anymore. And I think they needed someone to just say, hey, man, you know, someone a little older, you know, Pat, I'm 55 now. So, you know, I'm not going to argue with the kid, man. This is what I think. And you could take it or leave it. And they took it. And they haven't been back out there since then. So I feel good about that. So I think we're getting a little better with it.
That's good, Del. We appreciate you doing that. I see your Facebook posts. You know, obviously, I think that's important for you to put stuff out on social media so everybody really understands that this is real. And it's not going anywhere. It's not going anywhere until we correct this.
Yes. All right. Well, let's get started, man. I have to ask you because I want to know, and I want to know what you think, exactly what did we miss? I think we missed, Pat, I'm serious. I think we missed lead eight. And I think if you got hot, if you caught it, you know, maybe a Final Four or a run all the way to the thing, man. How do you think your team would have done in the Big Ten and the NCAA?
You know, the vibe was back. You know, the so-called experts, Jay Billis, I'll use his name on this one, you know, thought we had Final Four potential. And I didn't disagree with that. Myron Jones got sick there for a little bit, but guys really stepped up. We stubbed our toe and hit a couple speed bumps at the end. But the vibe came back prior to the Big Ten tournament. You know, new season, recalibrate, reset. We were ready to go. And Lamar just felt like the weight of the world was off his shoulders. First team all Big Ten, and Mike was feeling good. And I'm just telling you, those practices leading into the Big Ten tournament, I expected to play on Sunday that week. And then our goal was to go deep into the NCAA tournament. You know, our goal was to get to Atlanta. Let's not pull any punches here. Mm-hmm. We thought we were a team that could go very far, and we were trying to accomplish that. So I think we may have missed Penn Staters and all of Philadelphia may have missed a great run by these Philly kids to go in a deep run, because we had all the makings of a big time team.
I don't disagree at all. I'm convinced that Nova and you guys would have really represented the City 7 pretty good there, Pat.
I love when you pull out that City 7. I saw Joe Lunardi had us playing Villanova in the second round. I was like, oh, man. Woo.
I think
that would have been fun.
The United States would have gotten a good look at a real tough Philly ball club, man. I mean, Lamar Stevens, John Arar, Mike Watkins, Isaiah Brockington, Seth Lundy, all of these guys would have been on that national stage with all the eyes on them, and I think they would have really represented you very well. Is that
how? I don't disagree, man. Those kids that committed to Penn State, they put us, hey Dell, they put us on the map, man. We were top 10. We were ninth in the country for a couple weeks there. Yeah. We were top 25 for almost the entire Big Ten season. Yeah. I mean, and you know how hard the Big Ten was this year. It was brutal.
We gonna get to that, but I want to ask you: is the heavy Philly presence on your roster, is that by design, or does it just happen to play out that way? In other words, do you come here because these are the type of players you want, or because you have relationships, just because you know this is where you can get guys?
You know, it comes down to relationships for me. As you said, you know, born and raised in the area truly helps. And I'm at an age where the guys that I played against have kids that I can recruit, so they know me. Mm-hmm. And that there's trust there. There's belief there. And they know, they've seen what we've done since DJ Newbill. We've done right by DJ. We've done right by Shep Garner. We've done right by these Philly kids. And I think that's important, too. So, one, I would say relationship. And two, I would say, look, man, I want tough kids that compete, that want to win. And that's what you're getting from a Philly kid. And that's what's important. It's not just Philly kids, but that's the kids that you absolutely need. You need kids that want to win, that want to compete, that want to drive your program to new levels. And if you don't get those kids, well, guess what? You're not going to be here very long. Think about what Lamar and Mike have done for us over the last 4 years, Dell. 76 wins, most in Big Ten, Penn State history. 61 in the last 3 years, most in Penn State history. I mean, what these kids have done to put us on that stage. I'll bring Tony Carr back into that. I'll bring DJ back into that. I'll bring Chet back into that. And the guys that you currently have with Brock and Big Johnny. I mean, Seth Lundy, even though he went to Jersey, lives in Jersey, plays for Roman Catholic. So, I mean, I think having that mentality and that attitude and approach, I think we put ourselves in position to finish in the top 10, to finish in the top half, or at least the top six of the Big Ten. You know, on that average the last 3 years, we finished sixth. We finished tied for fifth, and we're in second place or third place most of the Big Ten season this year. And you know, thanks to Lamar and Mike for putting us in that position, along with Tony, along with the other great guys. They laid the bricks to put us in where we are today.
I think you deserve a little bit of credit, too, for guys like John Harar and Isaiah Brockington, because, you know, I knew those guys in high school, and I saw them, and I talked to both families when they were being recruited, and it wasn't a Big Ten kind of situation. So you saw something in these kids that said, you know what, hey, they can help me win on the road at Iowa, at Wisconsin, at Michigan, at Michigan State. And that's impressive, Pat, because a lot of guys, they'll wait, and, you know, the first question they'll ask you is, well, who else is recruiting them? Well, if you asked me that about John Harar, it might have been like Alvernia or somebody, man. And
hey, John Harar was about to go on a visit to Baylor for football.
Football, exactly.
Football. And then Temple football started coming in looking at him as well, recruiting him.
You trusted your own eyes, man, and you deserve credit for that because that's kind of a lost art in your business, man.
Yeah, I think the staff has done an amazing job at finding diamonds in the rough, finding a little something special about guys. John Harar, just talking to Philly Pride guys, talking to people around him. A great friend of mine, Kevin Towns, who I played at Philly U with back in the day. Guys like that you trust, that you have relationships with, you know, they said something's different about this kid. This kid's special. And you know what? He has been special. I'd say the same thing for Brock, being around, you know, those guys, those coaches, and then telling, hey, man, you got to take a chance on this kid. Well, you trust those guys. They would never send me somebody that didn't have something a little bit different, that drive, that competitive spirit, that competitive fire, that F you, if I can say, inside you, to come out and compete every day in practice and help us win. Yeah, at that level, in the Big Ten.
Yeah. Yes.
You know, and I'm excited about the development of John and Brock because they're the two guys that you're talking about right now. But, hey, I didn't start Seth Lundy the entire preseason or non-conference. He didn't start till Minnesota, which was in January. Talk about a kid with patience, who talking about a family who understood he's just not ready yet. And then when he was ready, bam, hit 6 threes at Purdue. Hits 3 threes at Minnesota, is guarding some of the best players in the Big Ten. He's got a long way to go, but that's the mentality that you need to have, especially in the Big Ten.
Well, I'm glad to see you getting it done. Now, you've been at Happy Valley it's 9 years now, man. Time is flying, Pat.
You see these gray whiskers? You see this? I see you got a couple there. You see this?
Yeah, they're coming in. They're coming in. But I remember it like yesterday when DJ Newble was trying to figure it out and he was thinking about Penn State. And I think, was he your first recruit?
He was the first. He was a transfer, first recruit for sure. I would say Brandon Taylor was right there, who played for Team Philly. So DJ and Brandon Taylor, you know, we got to give Brandon Taylor some love. Those guys really opened the door for us to Philly. But DJ Newba, I think everybody was kind of wait and see, Dell. Like, wait and see. Is he going to be successful? What's he going to do? How's he going to be played? And is he going to graduate? And you know all that. We try to graduate our Philly kids. And that's real important to us to stay loyal and committed to these guys through thick and thin. I mean, DJ was leading scorer in the Big Ten. He was first team all Big Ten. He went to Nike Skills Academy. I mean, which was LeBron back then, which is a big deal.
It's quiet, but he is an extremely confident young man. And, you know, I like to call him the King of North. And what did he bring to your program in terms of his attitude, work ethic, and skill level as you were just getting started in the Big Ten? Because it seems as though he's been instrumental in, like you say, the flood. A literal flood of kids that have followed him up to Penn State. What was it about him? Why was it so successful, that match between you and him?
First of all, the relationship that he and I had, he texted me when this virus hit, out of the blue, checking on me and checking on my family. If that doesn't speak volumes, you know, one of your former players right away hitting you up was special to me. It was his winner mentality. He had a winner's mentality and his toughness. That's what he brought to Penn State, and that's what we needed at that time. We needed someone who was tough and brought a competitive spirit to every practice, every drill, every rep. And I don't know if we had that when I first got there. And he brought that every single day. And if you're not tough, you know, playing in the Big Ten and playing for obviously me and my staff, then you're probably not going to play. And you know that, Dale, right? You know that. And DJ really built that up in our locker room, and he brought that to practice, and then it just stayed on from there.
All right. Now, you brought Big Ten basketball to Philadelphia. I'm going to give you that. I'm going to say that out loud. Because you, like me, you know, we grew up in Delaware County, man. You didn't grow up on the Big Ten. You know, Bobby Knight, Gene Cady, they just guys we saw on TV, Pat. We couldn't reach out and touch those guys. Now, even though Penn State's been in that league, I think 26, 27 years now, There was
Since 96 or 97.
Yeah, something like that. There was no real connection to the, you know, Big Ten, to the Philadelphia basketball scene. In fact, there was really none to the Big Ten. I think Big Roddy Jones from West Philly, every time I see him, he always tells me I need to let people know. He was the first Philly dude to go and pioneer in the Big Ten Conference. He played with, you know, those really good Illinois teams in the late early 90s.
Yeah, sure.
Since your arrival to the league, though, you kind of kicked the door in, man. It's like, in addition to, you've had about 30, 40 Philly kids up there.
Not that many, but quite a few for sure.
All right. Indiana's come down here and gotten a kid. Minnesota's gotten a kid. Maryland's got three currently on the roster. Rutgers is making noise, Pat. I went to a game up there. I was shocked at the atmosphere they're building up there.
Pikes has done a good job for sure.
Now, how much of the rebirth or the increasing presence of the Big Ten in the Mid-Atlantic region, how much of that credit do you give to you, your staff, and how much do you think it should be attributed to the Big Ten network? Because, you know, that's a factor too.
There's no question. Look, it goes back to relationships again. We could try to take all the credit we want, but it goes back to people believing in us and believing in the education that Penn State can offer you. And it gets kids, you know, only a couple hours away. So it's safe enough to go up here and have your own life, but still you can get back when you need to get back. Your family can come see you play. That's really important stuff. So, and that degree, Dale, you and I talked about the Penn State degree. We're talking 750,000 living, breathing, paying alums. We're talking about over 350,000 in the Pennsylvania area. You're talking a couple hundred thousand in the Philadelphia area. That Penn State degree, that education, really, it just gives you the opportunity. It sells itself. It sells itself. And I think you hit it right on the head. The Big Ten Network, it is just, it really is. It's huge as far as exposure. And that's what these kids want. They want to make sure NBA execs are able to DVR and watch their games. And if they're not coming to the games, to be able to watch it on television. So, I mean, we're on the Big Ten Network, the ESPN family, the Fox family, and we're on CBS. There's only one other professional sports organization, league, that has that, and that's the NFL. Think about all the exposure the Big Ten is getting. I mean, Jim Delaney was ahead of his time.
Way ahead.
You're right. And then, trust me, our budget has increased. Our budget has increased. The money we're about to make this year was going to be off the charts. Wasn't just football money, it was basketball money too. We were really going to help our department out because of the units, because we felt like we were going to get to the second or third weekend of the NCAA tournament. And now you're really, really able to help. Then the thing I would add to it, we brought Penn State basketball, Big Ten basketball to Philadelphia through the Palestra. The Palestra opened their doors for us. We had Michigan State there a few years ago, which went down as one of the greatest games ever. And then guess what? Iowa topped it.
Yes.
I don't know if you were at the game or saw the game, Dale. It was...
No, I wasn't, but I actually had a talk with one of the local kids who went there, and he just was blown away by Garza. Blown away. He's like, I didn't know who this guy was. He's the best player I saw all year. Garza.
And Garza was. And think about this game for a second. Garza had 34. There was 25 or 26 lead changes. Every Hoops Weiss, Dana O'Neill, all the big-time writers, right, were saying that felt like an Elite Eight game as we were going punch for – it was Ali Frazier. Let me throw some Joe Frazier at you, Dell. It was Ali Frazier just going back, forth. Lamar Stevens in foul trouble. Who steps up? Brockington. Brockington loves the Palestra. In the Catholic League Championship playoffs, he was dominant in those guys. He didn't make the championship game. He's in the semis, but he had a big game. He had another big game in that arena that night. So everybody really stepped up. Mike Watkins, the last 2-3 minutes, had a huge dunk and a big-time rebound. So I think when we bring in games to the Palestra like that – and by the way, it was sold out.
Yes.
You know, people said you can't sell out the Palestra. Penn State basketball can't sell out the Palestra. Well, I think we've proven them wrong.
With Iowa. So that's all Penn State. There ain't one too many Iowa dudes traveling in there, man.
There wasn't too many yellow jerseys there, yellow shirts. It was all blue and white. And let me tell you, it was about 100 degrees in that gym, Dell. It was old school, baby. The way it used to be played. No AC. We're all prima donnas now. We're all divas. We're all Whitney Houstons. Well, we got some nice, you know, it was steamy. It was muggy. People slipping.
That's plaster.
That's the plaster. That's the way it's supposed to be, man.
I actually think we're going through what I would describe as a structural realignment. I think the Big Ten is now a major player in the Mid-Atlantic region and on the East Coast because of you guys, because of Rutgers, because of Maryland. And I cover you, I cover Maryland, I cover Rutgers, and you have been very, very gracious over the course of the 9 years. I don't even think I have to make an appointment. I just jump in the car and say, I'm coming to Penn State, and I got somewhere to sit and think and do whatever it is I want to do when I get there. And, you know, you let me, you know, see the practices, see the facilities. And so I have the same kind of relationship in Maryland. So I'm watching what you guys have. You know, you guys live, work, eat, and play and travel absolutely first class. You and Maryland have NBA arenas on campus. How is your job at Penn State different from the job you had at Boston University? And do you think that the resource deficit that schools like Boston University is going to face going forward, when compared to you guys, will make the competitive imbalance too large?
Wow, that's a really good question. And it kind of goes back to some of the answers that we've already put out of here. But, you know, we're doing very well with ticket sales and revenues and concessions. Yeah. And our attendance has skyrocketed the last 3 years. And we have a pro arena. It's 15,255. Yes. We had a sellout this year. We had 13,000. We had 12,000. We had 13,000. I mean, we were averaging 8,000 or 9,000. I don't want to give you any fake news here, but it was around 8,000 or 9,000, which is big time, man, in the non-conference especially. So we got people that are coming out. So that's definitely one way we separate ourselves. The Big Ten Network, you just hit it on the head, man. They send a nice check out every year. The Big Ten 50, Conference,
50 million plus, man. Don't be modest. They send
a nice check out every year to help us.
Guys that don't get that, you know, Ryder, LaSalle, St. Joe's, Delaware, they don't get that check, man. How they gonna keep up, man?
It's gonna be hard. It really is. And I'll add football in there, but football really takes care of the masses, right? Mm-hmm. Basketball takes care of probably us and some other sports, and then football takes care of the masses. Penn State has 31 sports now. Mm. So that's a lot of mouths to feed. So football is 100 million. So they're taking care of a lot of people.
Everybody.
I think everybody used to say, hey, you're a football school, you're a football school. I said, hey, there's going to become a time when you need football money. And now we're seeing it. We're living it. We are living it today.
So wait a minute. So what you saying? Penn State's a basketball school now, Pat?
Hey, Dell, did we sell out the Palestra? That's all I would say. I mean, I
absolutely
think when people say, are you becoming a basketball star? I think Penn Staters want good basketball. And I think we have to stay consistent. And we have to keep winning. And that's how you're going to do it. NIT championship. Now this year, we 21 wins, 8 wins in a row, winning at Michigan State, winning at Michigan, winning on the road at Purdue, winning on the road at Nebraska, beating Maryland at home, beating Alabama, beating Georgetown at Georgetown when they were a whole, beating Syracuse in New York. I mean, we beat some big-time programs. Mm-hmm. And I think people on the national stage are starting to respect that. So I don't think it's a surprise when we were top 25. I think people expect it now. I expect it now. Our phone is ringing to take kids to – that wasn't the case four or five years ago. I mean, I was calling, you know, I was calling you every day. Can you help me out? I'm trying to get this kid on the phone. Nobody would even talk to me. And now we're getting calls and texts. Hey, you know, you only get 13 scholarships. So I think what we're doing is, you know, putting ourselves on that stage. And it's thanks to a lot of kids from the Philadelphia area.
So look, you've taken Newble from Miss Southern Miss, Brockington from St. Bonnie's, now Sessoms has verbally committed to coming from Binghamton. The NCAA is clearly headed towards eliminating that year in residency requirement. I don't know if it'll take place this year or next year. But once that comes down the pike, do you think that the transfer portal will become as important or maybe even more important as the primary, you know, target as you guys try to maintain this level of success that you have, even more so than high school and AAU?
It's such a great question, Dell. I think everything's going to be real fluid. We've been talking about it as a staff ever since the vote was coming down the line. Obviously, it's been pushed back now due to the coronavirus. But I think recruiting is going to really change. Yeah. We have a great culture right now, again, because of all the kids that have laid the bricks for this great foundation that we have, really great family atmosphere. How is that going to change? That's kind of a wait and see, right? I still want to bring kids out of high school to be a part of our program and have them grow.
Yes.
Yeah, I want to have them grow and develop under us. I think we've proven that. ESPN put out a statistic a few years back saying we were number 7th in the country as far as player development. I think that's important. We do a nice job, and you know this, of taking a young man and becoming an adult, a mature adult. That's not just developing on the court, but developing off the floor, developing in the classroom. I think holistically, that's what we've done. I want to continue to do that. It's going to get harder though, right? Because guys are going to start recruiting off your bench. They're going to be looking at your roster. Who's not happy? Who's disgruntled? Who's upset? Recruiting as we know it is going to change. Why would you go after a junior in high school or a senior in high school?
Yes.
When you can go recruit off somebody else's bench that's older? Because the goal is, and you know this, Dell, when you're older, especially the statistics are saying, when it's, you know, the Final Four teams of 2 years ago, they were all older teams.
Older guys, juniors and
all seniors. Older guys, juniors and seniors. Now, so somehow we're coming up with a formula to stay older, and that's what guys are going to do.
So that's interesting. You talked about maybe recruiting off of other guys' benches, and I think a lot of that's going to take place. But I also think that if you look at, like, the MAC, the MAAC MAC, the A-10, Conference USA, the Big South, even the MEAC, I think the all-rookie teams in those kind of leagues, I think within 2 or 3 years, we could see more than half of those kids just bailing after making all-rookie in that kind of league, because the opportunities to play right away in the much bigger league on TV, on the SEC network, the Big Ten network, the Big 12 network, the Pac-12 network, I think is going to prove to be irresistible. What do you think?
I don't disagree with you, Dell. Let me just backtrack real quick. I'm disappointed that I would have to do that, right, to recruit off somebody's bench. I don't want to do that. When I get a call and say, hey, such and such is thinking about transferring, I call the head coach out of respect, because that's the way I was taught. You know, Rolly taught Jay taught me, and I think that's what we try to do. We try to get ahead of it. We looked at a couple of kids this year from different schools, lower level, that I know very well and that I coach. Guess what? I'm calling those head coaches and saying, hey, I'm going to reach out to your guy. I don't know if everybody's going to do that. So somebody, John Rothstein, put this out. He's like, you know, lower to mid-levels are now going to be JUCOs. You know, a version of junior college. You know, all rookie teams, those dudes are gone.
Yes.
It's going to be like a minor league system, and I hate that. I hate that. I hate that for those coaches. I hate that for us. You know, who's saying somebody might not do it to us? Fortunately, we're winning right now. We're in a good space, and we're doing a nice job. We're playing in one of the best leagues in the country. So, okay. So we should be okay. But other coaches and other players, you know, they want to move on up. And how are they going to do that? Well, we're going to look at the all-rookie teams. We're going to look at the first team, you know, all whatever, the MVP if he's younger than the junior, or who shot the ball really well as a sophomore.
Yeah. Proven college players. These are proven.
And they played in college. They have college minutes. I'm fearful of what could happen. But I do think, you know, it's good for the kids, right? There are situations where it does warrant, you know, for them to go back closer to home, or something warrants. There are those situations, but there is going to be a lot of basketball decisions, and there is going to be a lot of mistakes, and that's what upsets me the most.
Well, another big change that I think is inevitably going to come, I don't know if it'll be as quickly as eliminating a year in residency. But I think they're going to have to allow these kids to be compensated for their likeness and images. Now, in your league, you know, in both Big Ten football and basketball, you know, we're talking about some pretty significant value on some of these kids at some of these schools. What are your thoughts on this? Should the players be allowed to, you know, make money from their likeness and images? If so, how should it be structured or regulated? Do you think this will alter the basic nature of what it is you guys are doing?
Yeah, Dell, you're hitting some really good questions and some points that we talk about in head coaches meetings quite often. And when the Big Ten head coaches meet and talk, we're talking about it constantly. I'm going on record. Yes, they definitely should get compensated. Why not? Mm. Right? Lamar Stevens would have crushed it this year.
Yes.
I don't know if you know this. He did a children's book. Mm. I mean, he really went out of his way to get out in the community and help the community. I'll go to Saquon Barkley. He could have really done some damage as far as helping himself and his family. But to focus on Lamar, what Lamar did this past year was amazing. And you know what? Mike Watkins, people don't know, but Mike Watkins is out in public all the time doing every charity event he could do. He goes to more games, other sports. Mm-hmm. He's always attending other sports to support his friends up at Penn State, which is amazing to me, and everybody might not realize that. But he does do that. Those guys could have helped their families this year. Absolutely. In doing little things. So I'm in agreement that they should get compensated in some sort of way. My fear is now third parties become really important. Third parties now try to broker deals. And now schools are going to use that. Hey, I can get you $100,000 commercial over here from a car dealership or a car, or I can that somehow, some way we have to manage that. Right? We already have a million rules in place. You and I can't stand all these NCAA rules, and it's got to be somehow that it's got to be structured better. Is there a commissioner that needs to oversee this? Somehow we have to do a better job. But how do we monitor that? I'm still in flux about that. I'm still digesting that and researching that in different ways, how it can be done. I know the NBA has sent down some things of what they do and how they get branded. And then it's the challenge of, is the guy in the locker room that's getting, I don't know, the car because he's doing commercials versus somebody else. Is there going to be animosity in the locker room now?
Yes, yes.
Now there's tension. Oh, he's making this. I need to be making this. Going to the coaches. Hey, we're supposed to be out of it. It shouldn't be tied to recruiting. That's what they're telling me. But now did you watch the scheme? Now you're really, did you watch the scheme on HBO?
Yeah, I saw it.
I watched it, and now all that, now I'm like, all right, wait a second.
Now
how's that going to go down?
What's the LSU or the quarterback worth? What's the Alabama quarterback worth? What's the USC tailback worth? What's the Duke point guard worth, you know?
Hey, what was Lamar Stevens worth this year? I mean, seriously.
Yes. Yes, big, big questions. Look, well, let's do full disclosure. I don't want to be faking nobody out. I understand Penn State basketball culture. I understand why kids are attracted to it. I understand what it takes to get kids, you know, on your radar screen. It just takes a phone call. You or Ergo will absolutely look at video, even jump in that nice, luxurious private jet you use. And
come on, Del, you're going to get me in trouble here.
And fly out to see kids. If people tell you that, hey, this kid could play, you'll just, you know, you have enough respect for people that you'll take a hard look at some video. You know, you'll evaluate it. But I want to ask you about Penn State in general, because I may have, you know, parents that look at what I do and their kid doesn't play football or their daughter doesn't run track. So tell me why Penn State, for just a student in general, tell me about the community, the school, the culture. Why Penn State, man?
I mean, holistically, I think it's just such a great place. It's a very safe campus. It's a very beautiful campus. You've been there. I've taken you on the golf cart. We've taken our tours. The facilities in general are top of the line. Penn State spares no expense when it comes to their facilities. As far as the academic, what the degree can do for a Penn Stater after he graduates, after the ball stops bouncing, it's just amazing. The resources, you know this too, Dale, the resources that we've had, you sat in those academic meetings. We have the Morgan Academic Resource Center off the charts. They have all the resources they need to be successful in the classroom to make sure that they stay on the court and earn their degree. That's very important to Penn State. And then the player development aspect, we have proven that we can develop pros now with Timmy Frazier and Tony Carr, now Lamar Stevens and Josh Reeves, and being able to go to the Nike Skills Academy and being first team all Big Ten, our leading scorer Big Ten. So holistically, bang, we are checking a lot of boxes for a lot of people out there and their families. And then the last piece is, you know, Penn Staters love Penn Staters. Mm-hmm. They really do. So when you put a resume out there, you know, they're going to see a Penn State on that final line and go, we got to hire this kid because we know how hard they work and what determination it is to be a great athlete, a great basketball player, football player, and, you know, get their degree. We want somebody like that on our team in the business world. I think that's critical. So I think holistically we're doing a lot of great things, and the experience of Penn State. Think about it. You got big time football, 107,000 fans. James Franklin's doing a heck of a job, and he recruits the heck out of Philly as well. There's a lot of Philly kids on that football team, and there's a lot of Philly kids in general on all 31.
Sharif Miller is on the Eagles, baby.
Yeah. So you got a lot of kids on the athletic teams. So there's people for them to hang out with. There's students for them to hang out with. I just think experience wise, you're getting the full experience from football to wrestling, to women's volleyball, to great lacrosse, to women's soccer. I mean, you are getting everything that you want out of the 4 or 5 years you're going to be at Penn State. So I think it's a powerful statement.
Well, my last question is, am I going to see Lamar and Mike in the league? I know they're right on that borderline, man. I don't know. You think they can make the league?
I do. I think Lamar is working. He's worked really hard. Hey, 2 years in a row, first team, all Big Ten. Mm-hmm. You know how hard that is to do?
Mm-hmm.
You know how hard that is to do?
He got cheated out of being an all-time scorer, didn't he? He got cheated.
7 points. 7 points. He had to play one game. All he needed was 6 minutes. He would have got 7 points in the first 4 to 6 minutes. It would have been over. But I'm very confident he's going to be on a team this year. We're doing a ton of interviews with NBA teams as we speak. And he is such a smart kid, and his family. Just a good nucleus, good inner circle there. I think they're going to be terrific. And we know Mike's challenges, but Mike's getting a ton of phone calls too. Mike's, you know, his path might be a little bit windier,
yeah.
but if he could just stay the course and stay focused on the task at hand, I was just texting with him before we got on this call, Dell, you know, making sure he's taking care of business. We want him to get his degree, first one in his family. What a miracle that would be. What an incredible accomplishment that would be. But also, guys are reaching out from the NBA saying, hey, this is what we need him to do. We need to interview him. We want more content. We want to, you know, we want to make sure we get him. You know, when all this coronavirus slows down a little bit and they can bring people in, they want to do that. So I'm very confident that these guys are going to be on a team in some capacity and sometime in their life.
Well, as far as the graduating part, I'm not at all concerned about that. Again, I've watched you and Ergo actually be a little bit more concerned about that than the actual kids once that, you know, that ball stops at Penn State. You know, those kids like to go off to camp, go work out, go train. But I've seen you and Keith, I've seen you guys stalk DJ Shep, and I know you'll be stalking Mike Watkins, making sure that he does what he needs to do to get that paper on his family's wall, man. I really appreciate you taking the time to do this, man. Please tell your missus that I said hello and to stay safe, and that I will be up there to see you guys as soon as this stuff blows over, man. We'll get up to Happy Valley again.
Tell, be safe, be well, give your best to your family. And everybody, please follow the protocols. Let's get back to normal.
Everybody loves the sunshine.
God bless.
Appreciate it. Yeah.
Appreciate you, baby.
Sunshine. Folks, get down in the sunshine. Sunshine.
Yeah.
folks get brown in the sunshine.